Let's go ahead and open our Bibles tonight to 2 Chronicles chapter 33. 2 Chronicles chapter 33. Before you know, are we done with this book? We're almost done, actually. 2 Chronicles 33, this is the chapter we'll be going over tonight. Let's go ahead and pray as we're coming to the Word of God. Lord, once again, we just present ourselves as your disciples tonight again. We come to hear from you through your Word, Lord. We come to see these examples that we have in your Old Testament, Lord. And may we learn tonight, and not just learn mentally, Lord, or comprehensively, Lord, but heart with our hearts, Lord. May we hear in such a way that we seek to love you more and more with our hearts and with our actions. In Jesus' name, amen. So 2 Chronicles 33, verse 1, it says, Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king, and he reigned 55 years in Jerusalem. Just by way of reminder, Israel has become a divided kingdom hundreds of years ago now. And the northern kingdom called Israel, mostly men in captivity at this point in time. And the southern kingdom called Judah, where, Jerusalem is. And that's what we're currently looking at, the southern kingdom of Judah. Hezekiah, if you remember, last time was a good king. He had a bout with pride, though, but the Lord kind of humbled him there, and he humbled himself before the Lord, and he helped to clean up the kingdom. He helped to bring back the Word of God and biblical worship there, and there was great excitement, if you remember. But now Hezekiah has died, and now his son Manasseh will take the throne. But notice he's only 12 years old, quite young to be taking the throne. And notice he's going to be on the throne, though, for 55 years. So look at verse 2, and this is where you can always tell. They always let you know at the beginning. I kind of like this, so there's not too many surprises, right? He says, but he did evil in the sight of the Lord, according to the abominations of the nations whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. Basically, this means that instead of following his father's example, he basically, who did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, he instead chose to worship the same gods that the nations around them had, who Israel had replaced. They were worshiping them. Now we must note here, note that the false gods that he worshiped were viewed two ways by the Lord here. Notice first it says that the Lord saw that what Manasseh saw was evil in his sight. And then secondly, the Lord considered this an abomination. These other nations who worshiped false gods. God is still the same. He still views false worship of other gods as an abomination. Those who pray to Buddha, those who worship, through Muhammad, the prophet Muhammad and Allah, an abomination before God. All these false religions, even today, we don't like to be that strong of words. Even Judaism has turned into an abomination before the Lord. It's a sad but truthful statement. And so we need to look at these things, though, in the same way that God does, that these things are evil, that these things are an abomination before him. And whenever we choose to do likewise, whenever we choose to follow the gods of this world, again, they may not be the world's religions, but they could be the god of psychology today. They could be the god of health today. It could be the god of television and entertainment today. Money, power, TikTok, if you will. So many different gods that we worship. Just be careful. Now, just because we may partake in some of those doesn't make them a god, but they can easily become gods to us. Be careful, because to the Lord, they're still evil and they're still an abomination. Look at verse 3. He didn't stop there. He rebuilt the high places which Hezekiah his father had broken down. He raised up altar for the Baals and made wooden images. And he worshipped all the host of heaven and served them. This is crazy. So he worshipped, notice here, you know, he rebuilt the high places which his father had torn down. I couldn't imagine, because undoubtedly there were some people who had helped tear down these very places, and now his son is rebuilding them. He raised up altars for the Baals. He made these wooden images. So, and notice, and he worshipped all the host of heaven and served them. So he's basically worshipping everything literally under the sun and around the sun, including the creation. Notice that, you know, he had the high places rebuilt, the altars raised up for Baals and, you know, the false gods of Baal. And then it says these false wooden images. And so these false wooden images were more than likely what they were, sacred poles that would have been dedicated to Asherah, the fertility goddess of the Canaanites. And so again, just going into wicked, wicked stuff. And he worshipped them and served them. And so again, what's terrible though is, remember, he's the king. And remember, guys and gals, that whatever we choose to go off into, if you're a parent, guess what? Your kids are going to be affected by whatever you do. If you're a boss at a work, or if you're a teacher in school, or if you're a pastor or in ministry even, and we start to go off base biblically, all those around us will be affected as well. And so again, look at verse 4. He just continues. He didn't stop there. He also built altars in the house of the Lord, of which the Lord had said, in Jerusalem shall be my name forever. And he built altars for all the host of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord. So not only did he build them in the high places around the city in Judah, he also built them in the house of the Lord. Notice it's pointed out again there, in verse 5, he built altars for all the host of heaven. So not only was he, you know, worshiping Baal and Ashtoreth, the false gods of the around them, but he also started to worship the heavens and the earth, all the things, the hosts of heaven, the moon and the stars. And again, this goes directly against the word of God in Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 19, Deuteronomy 4:19. It says, and when you look up into the sky and see the sun, moon, and stars, all the forces of heaven, don't be seduced into worshiping them. The Lord your God gave them to all the peoples of the earth. And so here he is falling into sin. And again, as you look at the beauty, if you've ever been out, on a very starry, beautiful night, or at the beach on a beautiful sunny day and the waves are crashing, there's a majesty. Where we live, even outside, just outside of Battleground, there's a lot of light pollution, so we don't get to see all the stars. But man, when you get out to the middle of the desert or up in the mountains somewhere and you can see all the stars, there's something in us. I believe that's why God warned even the people of Israel. When you look up to the sky and see the moon, sun, and stars, the forces of heaven, don't be seduced into worshiping them. And we have to be careful too. People today, there's probably all these UFOs and Martians out there and aliens all over the place, because look how vast the universe is. Imagine if we just believe what the Bible says, and that God created all these things after he created the earth, and that he did it so that we could understand and see his glory. That we would see these majestic things and see that God is above all these things. But again, don't be seduced into worshiping them. Look at verse 6. It says, also he caused his sons to pass through the fire of the son of Hinnom. Now, when we first hear that, it's like, oh, okay, they passed through the fire. No. You see, now he's doing what his wicked grandfather Ahaz did. Back in 2 Chronicles, you don't have to turn there. I think it's going to pull up there. 2 Chronicles 28, verse 3. 2 Chronicles 28, verse 3, we read this. He burned incense in the valley of the son of Hinnom and burned his children in the fire, according to the abominations of the nations whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. You know, it's an interesting thing. People say, well, this land isn't Israel's. This land is somebody else's land. No, you see, the land was given to Israel by God. And here's the thing. Since God created the heavens and the earth, he alone can actually say, this is your land, or this is your land, or that's not your land. And if you'll notice, the people that were in the land there, dude, they were doing such abominable things. They were taking their children and casting them into fires alive, to be burnt alive. And this is one of the reasons God had them clean out this area, to get rid of the wickedness. But now here's the king of Judah. Now he's doing it too. You know, he caused his sons to pass through the fire in the valley of the son of Hinnom. Verse 6 continues, he practiced soothsaying, used witchcraft and sorcery, and consulted mediums and spiritists. Now, soothsaying basically means to interpret the future by omens, looking for certain omens. Witchcraft, seeking to control others. Through communication with evil spirits. Sorcery, to gain power from evil spirits. And then notice it says he consulted with mediums and spiritists. Again, those who would mainly communicate with the dead. And so it goes on to say he did much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him, the Lord, to anger. You know, it's interesting again. Here is a man, he probably would even say that he was an Israelite. I'm a son of my father Abraham, and yeah, I'm doing these other things, but that's okay. No, it's not okay. And even notice he got into all this, witchcraft and sorcery and consulting mediums and spiritists. But there at the end of verse 6, we see that God calls this evil. It is evil in the sight of the Lord. It provokes God to anger. Even today, we must remember that these things God still considers evil. All this stuff, this witchcraft, witchcraft, sorcery, soothsaying, mediums, spiritists. And we need to be careful as Christians to understand that these things still provoke God to anger. And many of these things, I wouldn't doubt if some of us even here tonight or watching or listening haven't got caught up into some of this stuff even today. It's put forth as entertainment today. You have Shakira and other entertainers. They'll have, the sign of Satan or other symbols around them as they're performing. And it's no big deal. Of course it's a big deal. If it wasn't a big deal, then they wouldn't have it there, would they? So we need to be careful. There's things that, like Ouija boards, that I remember the kids asking about them when they were little. No, that's an opening to the spirit world. That's what's called the occult. A great book, by the way, on the occult it's called The Kingdom of the Occult by Walter Martin. You might want to pick that up. A great one to have in your library, along with Kingdom of the Cults. This is Kingdom of the Occult. But, Ouija boards, fortune telling, astrology. Hey, what's your sign, bro? Wicca. And then witchcraft, palm reading, tarot cards. These are not things for Christians to be involved in, even for fun. Hey, let's see what my, fortune is today. Other things that are tools of the occult, amulets, yoga, crystals, crystal balls, horoscopes, or they can be called birth charts or natal charts, magic, numerology, visualization, ruins, seances, spirit guides, even enneagrams. A lot of the church got caught up into enneagrams. They're total tools of the New Age movement going back to the occult. We can get caught up into the occult through video games, television shows, movies, cartoons, books, music. When these movies or televisions or games, when they put forth, you now have these demonic powers or you're fighting demons without the word of God, by the way. Do you ever notice that? You ever see a movie? Sometimes I've watched a movie, parts of a movie, just to see how are they going to combat this evil. I want to see that. And it's always, well, they find some ancient, accidental magic thing. So the devil is always real. Have you ever noticed that? Demons are always real. Ghosts are always real, but not God, right? And if they're angels, they're always wacky angels. No, that's all wickedness. So we need to be careful, spells and ghosts and sorcery, all those things. And we can get so used to things like Harry Potter and other things, and we need to be careful in this world, guys and gals, to be careful what we're taking in. I read this in The Kingdom of the Occult. It said this, it's an interesting to note that the Austrian Family and Community Development Committee did a project called Inquiry into the Effects of Television and Multimedia on Children and Families, concluded that repeated viewing of violence-themed media caused people to become accustomed to it and to gradually assimilate it into their worldview. And that's why you see Disney putting out cartoons that have, Satan's daughter in it. You have other video cartoons that Satan, I guess I could just call Disney Satan anymore. Where they're doing magic spells and other things. It's wicked, guys and gals. Be careful. Be careful. Remember what Jesus said. In Matthew 6:22-23, he said this, "The lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness?" Let me read this out of a paraphrase. It says, "Your eyes are windows into your body. If you open up your eyes wide and wonder in belief, your body fills up with light. If you live squinty-eyed and in greed and distrust, your body is a dank cellar. If you pull the blinds on the windows, what a dark light you will have." And even more so than that paraphrase, look, if we're always taking in dark things, I've talked before here, a lot of people like to watch horror movies. And I'll be honest with you, when I was a kid, I used to be, when I turned 16, dude, I'd be at the Texas Chainsaw Massacre and, Friday the 13th. And this, I'm talking back when they were all original in the theaters, all those movies, it was just fun. No, you know what? It was wicked. And we need to be careful because even today, all of a sudden, something goes bump in the night. And well, what do you think? You think of something from a movie or a book that you read. I remember my mom and dad, who never would have had this, but it was on television one time, The Exorcist. And this was back in the late 70s, early 80s, and we sat around as a family watching The Exorcist, a great family film, by the way. Just wicked. Don't be curious. Never heard of it? Good. Praise God you never heard of it. Put it under the blood and move on. Be careful, you guys and gals. We have to be careful and aware of what we're doing. Remember, if you believe we're in the last days like I do, that remember one of the things that characterized the last days and the days of Noah was there was great demonic activity. And I believe there's always been demonic activity, but I think Satan sees the signs just like we do. He doesn't control the signs, by the way. God does. And he's given us signs to look for. And I think that May 14th, 1948, when Israel became a nation again, Satan himself started telling his demons, dude, let's go because our time is almost here. Our time is almost here. And so we need to be careful, be aware of this wickedness that is all around us and not partake as the king is doing here. I love that old, song, "Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little eyes, what you see." And it goes on to talk about, "Be careful, little ears, what you hear." to be those who are careful what we're taking in, whether it be on social media, whether it be in books and televisions, movies, even music. Be careful, guys and gals. Look at verse 7. He even set a carved image, the idol, which he made in the house of God, of which God had said to David and to Solomon his son, in this house and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, I will put my name forever, and I will not again remove the foot of Israel from the land which I have appointed for your fathers, only if they are careful to do all that I have commanded them according to the whole law and the statutes and the ordinances by the hand of Moses. So notice, he even set carved images, idols which he had made, into the house of God. Guys and gals, be careful what we were just talking about, bringing these false idols into our houses of God. Oh, if we, do this incense, it'll get rid of evil spirits. Oh, if I have this lucky rabbit's foot, right? Oh, I just spilled a little thing of salt. I need to take some and throw it over my thing. Man, even as Christians, I've met so many superstitious Christians. To me, it's the same thing he's doing here. They're bringing this false idols into our lives. And what do they always bring? Fear. They always bring fear. Oh, I just walked under a ladder. I remember working in construction years ago. And, some guy, you just walked under that ladder. You're going to have 7 years bad luck. I go, watch this. And I go, woo, 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 woo. I walked under like 10 more times. I go, woohoo, come on, bad luck. Then we were doing demolition and I broke a mirror. Oh, there's more, whatever. It's like, I don't believe in that garbage because it's garbage. And I think God sees it the same even here as, here he is setting a carved image, the idol which he have made, in the house of God. Beloved, you and I are now the houses of God. We are now the tabernacles of the Holy Spirit of God. Be careful what you believe. When we go into a house, this is a haunted house. No such thing biblically. Could there be demons around? So what? Greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. You bring the Spirit of God with you, not a spirit of fear. He hasn't given you that spirit of fear. Remember that. But be careful what we bring into our Christianity. A lot of Christians around the world, and again, if you go to Mexico, if you go over to Jamaica, you go to different places, especially within Catholicism, they've mixed a lot of these false beliefs and bring in these false gods into their worship of Jesus Christ. Be careful. Be careful, guys and gals. But notice, here he was. He was so evil. The king didn't even care. He's bringing it into the house of God, even the very house. Notice the author even says to the house, that God himself said to Solomon, or David and Solomon, his son, all these promises. And then he says at the end of verse 8, if they are careful to do all that I have commanded them according to the whole law and the statutes and the ordinances by the hand of Moses. It's interesting today. There are so many who claim the name of Jesus Christ, and yet we believe that we can skirt the word of God. We believe that because of grace, for some reason, this is a weird thought, I don't adhere to it because it's not biblical, but we believe, so many within Christianity believe that because of grace, I no longer have to obey the word of God. That there's no whatever. But even here, look, God's promise to the Israelites, if they are careful to do all that I have commanded them according to the whole law and the statutes and the ordinances by the hand of Moses. Look, we are saved by grace. We are kept by grace. But that very grace that saves us, that very grace that keeps us, also leads us into good works. It leads us into obeying the word of God. Not perfectly, but that's where we're going to be going. That's the path that we are on. So if we think that we can ignore the word of God, if we think that we need not read the word of God and obey the word of God, then there is something wrong with our profession in God and the grace by which we say we stand. Be careful. God is not mocked. Look at verse 9. So Manasseh seduced Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to do more evil than the nations whom the Lord had destroyed before the children of Israel. What do you even say right now? I wrote in my notes, I have no words here. I mean, not only did he depart himself and do evil before the Lord, he also seduced many of the people of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem. Not only did he seduce them to do evil, but even more evil than had been done by those who lived in the land before Israel came. This is wicked stuff. You know, it's interesting. Even so many today who profess Jesus Christ, as we see the great falling away happening before us, and we see so many leaders within the Christian church taking so many, not just thousands or tens of thousands, but millions of people astray as they're following after. That's what happened here. King Manasseh, dude, he went off into left field. Be careful, beloved in Christ, because they followed him. They shouldn't have followed him. They should not have followed him. Look, if all of a sudden today I start teaching things that are not in accordance with the Word of God, run out that door. Come to me first, say, this is what the Bible says, Pastor Bill. We'll be praying for you. See you later. And go find a church that's teaching the Word of God. Sincerely. Look, guys and gals, we need to be so careful today. And also, what another great reminder for us, especially as parents. Look, Jesus said when he was talking to the scribes and the Pharisees, look, dudes, you're making your disciples twice the sons of Satan that you are. Be careful, guys and gals, because our children, if we're on fire for Jesus Christ, they may catch that fire, they may not. But if we're just kind of for Jesus Christ, and they're going to basically be even further away from Jesus Christ because they see, well, that's what a Christian is, what my mom and dad are, and they're not really on fire for Jesus. Why should I be on fire for Jesus? And as we go off, even as parents, and, you know, they see us watching things we shouldn't watch. They see us saying things that we shouldn't say. They're going to follow after. Look, here's the thing. Be careful, beloved in Christ. Take everything you hear taught. And again, for me, if I'm your pastor here tonight, from me first, take everything that you hear me teach. Anyone you hear on the radio, anyone you hear in a book or on television, a podcast, TikTok, wherever it is, television, and hold what they say up to the Word of God. Amen. Hold it up to the Word of God. Be a Berean. Don't be a lazy Christian. Today is not the days for lazy Christians. Lazy Christians hears these guys on TV and, oh, they sound so great, this guy on TikTok. Man, he made me laugh. What he's saying must be right. Oh, he's so excited about it. Look, they got thousands of people around him. They must be true. No, no. Be a Berean. Acts 17, 10 and 11. We read this, Acts 17, 10 and 11. Then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. When they arrived, they went to the synagogue of the Jews. These were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica. And in that they received the word with all readiness and searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. They didn't just believe what Paul and Silas were teaching them. Don't just believe what I'm teaching you, please. Please, I beg you. I beg you, because I will make mistakes, by the way. I'm a human being. Never look up to a pastor. You look up to them with the respect God has told us to look up to them with. You know, to follow them as they follow Christ. You know, treat them as the Bible says, but don't look up to your pastor or a religious leader like they are God. A worship leader who you love their voice or their songs. They're not God. I'm not God. There's only one God, and we ain't him. And his word is clear. Be careful today. Be careful today. I'm telling you what, during COVID, so many guys that I, and gals, by the way, that I loved and respected, you know, a lot of them just all of a sudden these leaders started going off into these weird things, man. I'm like, what did they just say? What did they just do? Look what the Bible says, and completely leaving it behind. And that's what's happening here. Look at verse 10. So in the midst of this, is they're going into all this wickedness, and the Lord spoke to Manasseh and his people, but they would not listen. You know what? I believe firmly that before God's judgment comes, God always speaks to his people. He always speaks to his people. You know, and basically he called them to repentance. That's what he was doing there. To turn away from their sin, their false gods, and turn back to him. And I'll be honest with you, I still believe God does the same thing today. I firmly believe that God speaks to us before his, you know, chastisement comes, because the Lord does chastise those whom he loves. And so here's the thing. Are you listening to God? Will we listen to God? I don't know about you, but I like to listen to the good things. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Man, I love to listen to the good things. Sometimes the tough things can be hard to hear. Hey, Bill, guess what? Your pride is in the way. Hey, Bill, guess what? You've been blowing it over here. Hey, Bill, guess what? It's like, oh, no, I'm too busy for that stuff, Lord. It's all good. It's all, you know, no big deal. It's all under your grace, and I'll just keep moving forward. That's not going to work out so well here. Look what it says, verse 11. Since they didn't listen, and by the way, you can count on this in your life if you're not listening to God. If you're his, by the way. Therefore, the Lord brought upon them the captains of the army of the king of Syria, Assyria, and took Manasseh with hooks, bound him with bronze fetters, and carried him off to Babylon. Do you ever notice how interesting it is that the Lord almost always uses the ungodly to punish his people? Very interesting, isn't it? Very interesting. Look at verse 12. Now when he was in affliction, now look what happens. He implored the Lord his God, humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers, and prayed to him. And he received his entreaty, heard his supplication, and brought him back to Jerusalem into his kingdom. Then Manasseh knew that the Lord was God. I love these two verses. I sincerely love these two verses. There's so much happening here. First of all, we see again the great grace, the great mercy, the great forgiveness of our God. You know, if you're lost in sin today, maybe you think you're so lost, there's no coming back. Maybe you're a prodigal son or daughter. Maybe you've never come to Christ. I don't know. Maybe you've gotten so into sin in your life, even as a Christian, you're just kind of lost. Look, come back to the Lord. Implore him. Humble himself. It's so interesting. Notice what he did here. First, he sees that he was in affliction. He noticed his own affliction. He recognized that this just wasn't a coincidence that the Assyrians came in. And he knew that this was God. And so he recognized first his affliction. Then the next step is he implored his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his father. Look, all of a sudden he forsook the other gods. But notice, you know, he implored his God. He humbled himself greatly. You know, I think this is where we can all get hung up, isn't it? I think we can all get hung up in the humility part. You know, the hardest thing to do is when you're counseling somebody or talking to somebody and they're in sin and they don't want to admit they're in sin. Even though you point it out clearly in the Bible, they go somewhere else. Well, you know, God's grace, God's forgiveness. Yeah, but you're still living in the sin. You haven't turned away from it. You haven't humbled yourself before God. That can be the hardest thing, because we then have to admit. We just sang a song. I forget the exact words, but as I was singing, I'm like, boy, this sounds like the study tonight. Because it says, oh, we love to humble ourselves before you. We love to confess our sin before you. If we're honest, most of the times we don't. Because of our pride, even as Christians, we don't want to admit that we were wrong on this. We don't want to admit, because the other side of it too is our laziness, if you will, because then we'll have to change. A lot of us don't want to change. Who wants to change? I do. You, do you? Do you want to be more like Jesus? Or do you want to be more and stay like yourself? To change, it takes humility. He implored his God. Notice, he humbled himself before his God. And so again, this is where we need to come and admit to ourselves and to God and ourselves and even others sometimes that we have sinned, that we have blown it. And yet then go on. Don't stop there, by the way. Don't stay there. If you're in Christ, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Remember this. But again, as we move on then, as we confess, as we turn away, as we humble ourselves, we move on and receive God's forgiveness and mercy. So he greatly humbled himself. Notice it goes on to say in verse 13, he prayed to God, and God received his prayer, heard his supplication, and brought him back to Jerusalem. And notice at the end of verse 13, it says, then Manasseh knew that the Lord was God. Notice he didn't change. Once he got back, he didn't say, oh good, let's go ahead and start worshiping the false gods again. No, he recognized this whole thing was of God. Isn't that the worst thing in the world when somebody's going through something and, oh, I need the Lord, I need you so bad. God comes in, does a radical work, and what do? When they get back? They go back to the same thing. It's like, oh, no, I could have had a V8. No. Look, guys and gals, even in our lives when we repent, let's not be those who go back. Let's recognize the forgiveness of God. Let's acknowledge it, because that's what he does. Then Manasseh knew that the Lord was God. Look at verse 14. After this, he built a wall outside the city of David on the west side of Gihon, and in the valley as far as the entrance of the fish gate, and then it enclosed a fell. And he raised it to a very great height. Then he put military captains in all the fortified cities of Judah. Look, he had been taken captive. So what? The first thing he does when he gets back is he refortifies Judah. What I love about this is he believed that God delivered him, but then he also acted in wisdom, right? And it's okay to act in wisdom, beloved in Christ. We look around us today, we see all these things happening. Just like Joseph, when he was in Egypt, the Lord showed him what was coming. He could have just ignored it. Well, Lord, you're going to provide. No, this is what I want you to do. And God revealed that. Be wise today. So that's what I believe he's doing here, is being wise. But notice too, verse 15, we see a continued fruit of his repentance. Notice, he took away the foreign gods and the idol from the house of the Lord, and all the altars that he had built in the mount of the house of the Lord and in Jerusalem, and he cast them out of the city. I love this. He didn't just stop. He did. He put some rubber to the road. Verse 16, he also repaired the altar of the Lord, sacrificed peace offerings and thanks offerings on it, and commanded Judah to serve the Lord God of Israel. Again, I love this. His professed faith resulted in good and godly works. I love this. May this be the same in our lives, beloved in Christ, as we make a profession of our faith. May we not rest there. May we rest only as we continue to walk with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as we work out our salvation with fear and trembling, knowing that he is working in and through us for his good pleasure at the same time. It's glorious. It's wonderful. It's beautiful. And so again, you know, we see his faith being put into action. Nothing worse than someone who has a profession of faith, but there's no action applied to it. Terrible. Look at verse 17. Now, notice that there at the end of verse 16, he commanded all of his, Judah to serve the Lord. So that's his command, but look at what verse 17 says. Nevertheless, the people still sacrificed on the high places, but only to the Lord their God. I don't know about you, but it seems like we really enjoy to be partially obedient to the Lord, right? We like to obey the Lord till it hurts, amen? We like to obey the Lord till it causes sacrifice, right? It costs us something. If it costs me something, I don't need to obey the Lord. I've heard so many people say that about tithing.
Oh, I can't afford to tithe, it might make me, not be able to afford to do things that I want to do.
It's like, so you're, oh, Lord, I'll obey you, but just to the point where I feel comfortable. And that's what they're doing. So even though they turned away from most of their unbiblical practices, they still chose to sacrifice things on the high places rather than doing what God had commanded them to do, and that was to go to Jerusalem and sacrifice at the temple. They knew this, but it was more convenient. It's more convenient just to, do it at the high places right down the street. Why would we have to take the trek all the way into Jerusalem? It doesn't matter. And again, sadly, we can be the same way, can't we? I don't know. It's a weird thing. I don't understand it. I'll just be really honest. When people say they love Jesus and then they ignore his word and they don't care about doing anything that's written in his word, and I don't get it. And that's kind of what they're doing. They'll obey part of it, but they won't obey the whole thing. Now, again, we're never going to be perfect at obeying the Lord. That's this side of, until we get our new bodies, right? But again, that should be our hearts, to love the Lord, to honor him with our works, to be obedient because we do love him. And not just have our lips, bless the Lord, but our hearts blessing the Lord. Amen. So sad. Again, may we learn from this tonight. Don't hear these. If this is you tonight, don't hear this and just say, oh, that's Pastor Bill. He's legalistic. You come and show me where I'm being legalistic, please. You're just wrong. I'll just say it flat out. I don't have any problems. Verse 18. Now the rest of the acts of Manasseh, his prayer to his God, and the words of the seers who spoke to him in the name of the Lord, God of Israel. Indeed, they are written in the book of the kings of Israel. Also his prayer and how God received his entreaty and all his sin and trespass and the sites where he built high places and set up wooden images and carved images before he was humbled. Indeed, they are written among the sayings of Hosea. So Manasseh rested with his fathers, and they buried him in his own house. Then his son Amon reigned in his place. So notice briefly, we don't know. Remember, this is 55 years of history we just covered, in a few paragraphs. So we don't know how long. I got a feeling that most of the time before he was taken to captivity to Babylon, that most of his reign was just wicked. Because the reason I say that, look at verse 20 again, if you notice that. They buried him in his own house. You see, most of the other kings that were godly kings, they were buried with their fathers. They didn't do that with him here. An interesting thing. So now his son Amon reigns in his place. Verse 21, Amon was 22 years old when he became king, and he reigned 2 years in Jerusalem, only 2 years. But notice verse 22, but he did evil in the sight of the Lord, as his father Manasseh had done. For Amon sacrificed to all the carved images which his father Manasseh had made and served them. And he did not humble himself before the Lord. See, there's the big difference, isn't it? You see, his dad had finally humbled himself before the Lord. Oh, but not so with Amon. It goes on to say, as his father Manasseh had humbled himself, but Amon trespassed more and more. Then his servants conspired against him and killed him in his own house. But the people of the land executed all those who had conspired against King Amon. Then the people of the land made his son Josiah king in his place. Now next week, Lord willing, and we're all here, we're going to get to King Josiah. And even though he was only 8 years old when he took over being king, we're told that he did that which is right in the sight of the Lord, and walked in the ways of his father David, and he did not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. Some good stuff coming. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much, Lord, for the good, the bad, the ugly, the true, the beautiful, Lord. And I pray that as human beings, Lord, as your sons and daughters, Lord Jesus, that as we hear these words of Judah, they wouldn't just be words on a page, but they would be what they are, truly living, Lord. And that your word would have your perfect way within each one of our hearts, those here, those watching or listening, Lord. Father, we just humble ourselves afresh before you, Lord Jesus. May you search our hearts, Lord. See if there be any wicked ways within us that we've come to kind of embrace or ignore. Would you show us, Lord, and then by the power of your Spirit and grace in our lives, help us to humble ourselves before you and turn away from them and enter afresh into your forgiveness and new life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.